Hi, I'm Sean, electrician with Heritage Home Service, and today we're going to be talking about what we do during electrical safety inspection and why it's important for your home. All right, so we're out here at the electrical meter. What we want to do is open it and check for any rust or corrosion. So inside here, we've got our main feeders from the telephone pole coming in. We want to make sure they're nice and tight and they have antioxidant solution on them. We also want to see if the connections going into the house are nice and tight and have antioxidant solution. Next thing down here, we can see the cable going inside the house. We want to check for any cracks or any signs that is end of life or any water damage. Coming down here, this protects against water going into your home. This is a sill plate that protects the wire at most vulnerable angle, the bend going into the house. While we're out here, let's check out our AC disconnect. So the AC disconnected is for service members that are coming here to service your AC equipment, and they can quickly shut down the equipment while you might be away or not at home. So inside, we want to make sure that the connections are tight and that there's no signs of corrosion, dust or dirt, or any signs of a rodent has made their nest here. And this system looks good. So we're down here in the basement, and we're looking at our electrical panel, the heart of the electrical system. Inside, we've got our power coming in to the main breaker. This is the main breaker for the home, and down here we have the branch circuit breakers. First thing we want to check in the panel is the labels. Are they properly labeled, and do they have it complete? The main importance of this is if the power goes out, we want to make sure that we can reset this properly and turn it on. The other important thing is for safety aspect. If we're doing projects in the home, we want to safely turn off the circuit breaker so we can work on this without getting hurt. Next thing I want to talk about is surge protection. So we might have surge protection for a computer or a TV, but what about our other appliances? So we have a dryer or a stove. We can't naturally plug in a surge protector there. What we do have is a device that goes right into the panel, and this protects the whole home and all of its circuits. We can tell that this surge presser right here has a green light, and that means that the whole home is protected. The surge protector acts like a sponge, and it sucks up all the extra energy from maybe a transformer blowing, and this would protect our devices in the home. Next thing we're going to do is take off the panel cover and take a look inside. So we've taken off the panel cover here. First thing we want to do is general well-being. We want to look at the panel and see if there's any signs of rust or corrosion, dirt or dust buildup. And we also want to make sure there are no signs of rodents that have made a home in your panel. Next thing we want to look at is the main feeders coming in. These feeders are coming from your electrical box outside, your electrical meter. This wire, we want to make sure if it's nice and tight, and it also has an antioxidant solution. There's two things that the antioxidant solution does. It protects the wire as it expands and contrasts, and also protects against rust and corrosion. Next, we're going to be looking at your breakers and the circuits that feed it. We want to make sure they're nice and tight. We also want to make sure the wire size is proper. If the wire size is improper or there is a loose connection, this can cause loss of power and or a fire hazard. But this panel looks good. Next thing I'd like to talk about is our grounding system. So outside we have our main grounding system coming from the telephone pole to the electrical meter. But what I really want to focus on is our supplemental grounding. So outside we have two grounding rods. They're 8 foot long copper tubes that we put 6 feet apart from each other. They're a good backup, but they also serve as an excess place for the electricity to go if there was a surge. Electricity always likes to go back to ground. We just give it a place to go. Inside, we also have a water bond. So the pipe inside here we have is the main water feed from outside. This copper pipe is touching the ground and is a perfect grounding electrode. So down here is the street side. We also have another clamp above the water meter here, and that is the house side. If the connection were ever severed here, both parts would be fully grounded. The system looks good. Next thing we want to look at is other systems that could benefit from the grounding system, like gas piping. We have the main gas pipe coming in here. We have some CSST piping, which is corrugated piping, and the gas piping bonds, or the clamps. Gas piping can benefit from a grounding system. One, if a live wire hits the pipe, it would protect against that live wire and ground itself out. But also like surges or a lightning strike, the corrugated CSST pipe can rupture. And most manufacturers now recommend we bond these systems when we put them in. This grounding system looks good. Next thing we'd like to talk about is outlets and GFIs. So GFIs are in a couple of different places. Outside, garages, basements, bathrooms and kitchens. Right now we're in the bathroom. We're going to check out this GFI. GFIs are, their main purpose is to interrupt the electricity if we introduce it to water. So say we had something plugged in here in the bathroom and the cord was frayed. There was some water exposed. I put my hand in here. This GFI would trip and stop the electricity. Let's test it out. This is a plug tester. This will simulate a ground fault. The GFI has tripped. We're going to reset it. You can also test it at home by yourself. This is a test button here. The GFI has tripped and we can reset it. The other thing we want to do is see if it's properly wired. This plug indicator also has indicating lights and it will tell me that it's properly wired. This one looks good here. Let's go check out another standard plug. So now we're at the standard plug. We're going to check it and see that it's wired properly. Like the GFI, we're testing and seeing if they have the right indicator lights are on. This looks like it's properly wired. A couple things that we want to look for. Inside the plug, we're looking for any red flags, wiring methods, if it's backstabbed, if there's any loose terminals that should be screwed down. We're going to open this up and take a peek inside. All right, I'm going to start taking off the cover here. All right, now that we got our plug unscrewed, let's pull it out to check it out. All right, first thing we want to check, see if there's any major cuts or damages to the wire. This looks good. Next thing we want to check for is if there's any backstabbing of the plug. So let me turn this around. We can see the backside. These ports right here, that is a backstabbing port or a quick connection. Over time, if we use those ports, the wire can back out and cause a loose connection. You can potentially lose electricity or cause a fire. This is the proper method. It's called a terminal loop. The hook is facing upwards on this side and it is tight around the screw. There's no plastic touching the connections. Check out the other side. Again, it's turning with the screw. Nice clean hooks, no plastic showing underneath the screw. And we'll also look at the ground. Good connections there. If this was a plug with maybe one wire, we'd want to make sure that the wire underneath is nice and tight, but also the unused connection is not sticking out. In this case, this is a plastic box here. But if you had a metal box, these terminals could hit the metal box and cause a fault. When we're putting it back in, we also want to make sure it's tight. When we're checking the plugs, we're seeing if the plug and the box are stable. This box is nice and stable. And going in, it was pretty stable going into the wall. This plug looks good here. So the next thing I want to talk about is light switches and the lights. So over here, it's kind of cool, is a screwless plate and a dimmer. One thing I just wanted to mention here is that we can change or upgrade any of your existing light switches to maybe a different color or a different design, or upgrade it from a screwed plate to a screwless plate, or update your existing switch to a dimmer, or maybe even a smart switch. Smart switches can be controlled by an app or a smart speaker, can be turned on at certain parts of the day. If you're interested in that, we have a separate video that you can check out now. But let's get back and start opening up this switch here. All right, we're gonna start by taking off this plate here. So it's gonna pertain to much of the same things that we looked at in the plug are gonna echo over here at the switch. We just wanna make sure that the wires are connected properly. But if this was a three-way location, we also wanna make sure that both switches in the three-way location work. So a three-way means that it can be controlled from two points in maybe a certain area, most likely a hall or a stairs, top of the stairs and the bottom of the stairs. And if one location turns it on and then the other location doesn't work, we can fix that for you. All right, let's pull out the switch. This is good here. We got a nice tight wires with terminal loops. The wires don't look frayed at all. Another thing we want to check if there's a ground. Most dimmers have a pigtail that come off, but this is connected to the ground here. We also just want to pull out the neutral and make sure that that splice is nice and tight. Splice looks good. Let's turn off this switch and just take a peek at the connection here. Those splices look nice and tight. We're going to put this back on and turn the lights back on. So overall, the switch is in good shape. Next thing we're going to be talking about is the lights. So next thing we want to talk about is lighting. The key aspect is safety. So we might have a dark place in our home or inadequate lighting. Maybe a kitchen, maybe there's a dark spot where we're cooking and there's not enough light. Or a hallway, we get to the other end and there's not a lot of light there. Or maybe in our bedroom, there's not a center light, maybe there's just a lamp. Or stairs, what if we're going down to the basement and there's that one light down at the bottom, but there's not really a lot at the top. We're gonna talk about lighting, but one thing I wanna touch upon is LED lights and how it can brighten up your space and also save you some money. So what we have here is a traditional recess can, and this is called a retrofit trim. So what this is sort of, it take the old system and you can update it to LED. This retrofit trim has a built-in LED bulb with a new trim. Sometimes in older homes, the trims can yellow and the bulbs can be costly to replace every year. This trim can last up to 10 to 15 years and save you a good amount of money. It's pretty easy to install. Simply take the old socket and screw in the new LED trim. And that's it. Last thing I want to talk about is smoke detectors. They're a key life safety device in our home. Smoke detectors can alert us to fire or CO within the home. Let's look at the smoke detector. So we can tell that it's a hardwired smoke detector. We can tell that there's a feed wire, the white and the black wire. We also have our red wire here. This sends a signal in between the alarm, two other alarms, so that they can sound. Next thing we want to look at is the date code, 2016. This detector is good. It's within its 10 years. Manufacturers have to adhere to a 10-year guarantee that the smoke detector is going to operate. After that 10 years, the detector can become a little inefficient. Sometimes it will set off randomly, or it might not go off at all. Let's put this back up. Last thing we want to check and see is the last time the battery's been changed. After all that, we're going to test it. But before that, we want to talk about different jobs that the smoke detectors do. Some smoke detectors have a combination device, smoke detector and CO. Some smoke detectors are just that, a smoke detector. Some smoke detectors might be just a heat detector, and we'd find those in a garage. Depending on your different bylaws, they are required in different areas of your home. Always check with your local or state bylaws before we install them. Last thing we're going to do is hit the test button. When we hit the test button, a sound will sound at the location, but we also want to check out the other areas of the home that's going off in those areas. We've already checked this out, and the system looks good. And that concludes our electrical safety inspection. I hope you found this informative. If you'd like to book your own safety inspection, call or book online. Thanks for watching.